We're saying we spoke to the hospitality industry about the government's decision to fully reopen our borders in July, as well as changes to rebalance our immigration system. So zooming in from Wellington to explain why he feels the changes are necessary and what they're intended to achieve, we're joined by Immigration Minister Kris Faafoi. And we're so appreciative of your time this morning, Minister. How are you?
Good, Matty. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. How big of a problem has this been over the last couple of years in terms, while we've been weathering COVID, in terms of not having that migrant workforce?
Well, it's been massive for businesses. It's been one of the biggest pressures that the government has faced, that while we obviously had to close the border for public health reasons, that meant that people who had skills that businesses wanted here in New Zealand found it very difficult. We were able to let about 30,000 critical workers in during that period. But obviously that is in nowhere in comparison to what would have usually crossed the border if the borders are open. So the immediate problem around the border opening, I think people will be happy that July 31st, we'll be able to let everyone back into the country, we'll be fully open. But the issues that we're looking at, that we've been looking at in terms of the wider immigration settings, have been an issue for some time. We gave people a heads up about a year ago via a speech that Stuart Nash gave on my behalf. And so we've been working behind the scenes with the likes of the Hospitality Association and other sectors to make sure that we try and get that balance right of trying to attract skilled workers and making sure that some of those sectors who have traditionally relied on lower paid migrants can transition away from that, or look at making sure that New Zealanders can be more of an option for them in the future.
Yeah, because it is a balance, right? And I look at the state of things pre-COVID, and I wonder if we became too reliant on migrant workers. Between 2012 and 2019, the number of migrant workers employed in New Zealand increased by approximately 144%.
Yeah, and look, at the same time, the domestic labour force grew about 15, so it was out of kilter. And that was having an effect on people that we're bringing here, especially into lower paid jobs. There was, exploitation going on that we've had to respond to, but also importantly, we want to make sure that we're transitioning to a higher wage, higher skill economy. It's going to be better for us in the long run.
So quickly talk us through some of the major changes that you've announced.
Well, something that's been out there for a long time is the $27.76, the median wage threshold that you've already mentioned today. So if employers are accredited, they're paying the median wage, they test the local market, so they advertise a job and they can't find someone suitable, they'll be able to bring somebody in from offshore once we do the normal checks on that individual. So people will still, and businesses will still be able to bring people in. One of the big things that we're obviously facing at the moment is attracting highly skilled workers that are in occupations that are in demand, which is why yesterday we announced the green list of a little over 80 jobs, which will have a streamlined pathway to residence. That will mean employers who need those workers can go out there and advertise those jobs in the international market and say, come to New Zealand, we've got a job for you. In most instances on that green list, they'll be able to get residence almost instantly when they get the visa. And in some instances, for about 30-odd jobs, after 2 years, they'll be able to be eligible for residence. So that is the kind of measure that we need to make sure that we're attracting those high-skilled workers, giving them certainty, and also giving employers another tool to say, we want you, and if you come here, you can stay.
And I think that all makes perfect sense, especially if we're looking at the possible brain drain that we've been talking about a lot on Breakfast recently, with a lot of New Zealanders possibly looking to move overseas with the reopening of the world. But I look at those industries that are really reliant on low-skilled migrants, like tourism and hospitality. And we spoke to the Hospitality New Zealand just before we spoke to you, and there are some real concerns about how that sector is going to plug gaps.
Yeah, look, they've had a tough time in the last couple of years, obviously, and in speaking to Julie during this whole process, we came to a position where we understood that they need a time to transition, and that $27.76 is going to be very tough for those sectors to be able to keep employing people. So the ability for them to, as already been mentioned this morning on the show, to be able to continue to employ people up until 2023 April, at $25, it gives them some transition. Those particular sectors, Matty, have really relied on the likes of working holiday visas and students in the past. Those visa options have opened about a month ago, or just about to reopen. So we need to make sure that we give them time to adjust economically, to make sure that they can afford to pay more, but also to make sure that those workers that they've traditionally relied on, those who are coming here for holiday and will work at the same time, can get back into the country too.
Julie's really concerned about that transition period, though, and what it'll mean for us at home who go to the bars and restaurants and cafes. This is what she said to us, to Jenny May, a little bit earlier on in the show.
This is actually a shared problem. We need waitresses, we need duty managers, we need chefs. So it's a shared problem because your consumers will end up with higher prices. Consumers will get less choice. So this is an all of us issue now.
It is an all of us issue, isn't it? Because, you know, we talk about trying to train up New Zealanders and get them into the workforce as well. But these are industries that are really heavily reliant on these migrants.
Yeah, and that's why working holiday visas were one of the first categories of visas that we opened up in order for when we do have visitors coming in back in en masse, and now that will happen on July the 31st, that those sectors that, you know, need to make sure that we can staff restaurants and bars have the staff available. They're still struggling. I think most people who have been gone to a bar or restaurant may have found the wait times a little longer for food because of the shortage of staff. As we've progressively said that we'll open up, again, we prioritise the likes of working holiday visas because that's the kind of visa holder or staff or labour that Julie and her sector have relied on for many years now. And we made sure that that opened nice and early so we could get them through the process of getting a visa, but also making sure they had the time to get into the country. And that is happening, but it's happening slowly. So that's why we gave them time to be able to transition to that position in April of next year.
You may have heard Jenny May read some feedback from one of our viewers just before we connected with you, Bob. Said there's something that doesn't feel right, that we should be importing cheap labour to help some businesses increase profits. Was there evidence to suggest that we had been exploiting migrant workers pre-COVID?
Well, there were pockets of worker exploitation and people were held to account and businesses were held to account. But across the board, I think the likes of working holiday visas come here to study or have a holiday and work at the same time. So that is something that's been happening for a long time. People come here, Kiwis go offshore and do that too. But as you mentioned at the very beginning of this interview, the increase in the number of temporary work visas that happened between 2012 and 2019 was huge. We've made no secret and we've made no apologies that we want to make sure that we have a smarter immigration system and move to a higher wage, higher skill economy. And what we've announced in the last 24 hours lays the foundation for that. We're working with some sectors, likes of care, meat processing, seafood, building and construction to make sure that they can transition as well, because they are sectors that have traditionally relied on workers that are below the median wage. So we need to make sure we can give them some time to transition that. Part of that deal is that then they also need to make sure that they're looking at hiring New Zealanders where they can and getting into training, but also if they can invest in assets and plants to make sure that their productivity can increase, they do that as well.
Yeah, I guess a lot of businesses, though, would be concerned about the fact that they're needing to transition, they're needing to train up workers. I read a story about a restaurant owner in Queenstown who's gone from a staff of 32 to a staff of 6. And over the school holidays, he had to put an SOS out on Facebook asking for his friends and family to come and plug the gaps in his restaurant to make sure that he could keep operating. And these are businesses that have really, really struggled over the last couple of years through COVID. So I guess the concern is that through that transition phase and through the training up of New Zealand staff, a lot of these businesses might not actually be able to survive.
And that's why for businesses like that, Matty, who have traditionally relied on the likes of working holiday visa, people coming here and working in hotels and bars, that we prioritise that category of visa opening. There's also longer-term issues that we want to address in terms of making sure we do give New Zealanders the opportunity to get into entry-level work as well, and that's what we'll work with a number of sectors to do, as well as the hospitality and tourism sector.
Just quickly before we go, there have already been some issues around the length of time and Immigration New Zealand has been taking to process visas. Are you confident that Immigration New Zealand will be able to keep up with the demand?
Look, in a nutshell, yes. We've hired about 230 more staff. We've got a different online application system, which will give a better user experience for people for applying for visas. So I think a bit of frustration will be taken out of the equation there. That system also allows us to dynamically move between visa processing, so we'll be able to better manage. We're essentially moving from a paper system to a digital system. It's 2022. I thought that could have been done earlier, but I think we've done as best as we can to make sure that we're ready. That's why we are taking to a degree a staged approach in terms of what visas we have prioritised, because both the processing and making sure that we get the people that we need at the right time as we reopen the border.
Minister, we so appreciate your time this morning. That's Kris Faafoi, the Immigration Minister, joining us from Wellington. Thank you so much.